Welcome. My name is Craig Miller, and I'm the minister here at Knox United. And I'm in very good company today as I'm joined by Jane Skinner. This is a service for the Sunday after Christmas, but we're recording it on Tuesday the 22nd. So if between now and then the world comes to an end, here we are. No, we're looking forward to the days ahead and celebrating Christmas and Christmas Eve with you. A simple service today. You'll find an order of worship on our website. We won't be singing together today. Jane will be playing some music for reflection. We'll be hearing from the gospel text for the Sunday after Christmas, and we'll have some time to think about this past year and transition to the new year to come, which I'm sure we're all ready to do. As you join us at home, let me say, the peace of Christ be with you and also with you. Let us join together in prayer and invite you to rise in body and spirit as we join in a prayer with the four directions. I'm not going to turn so that you can hear me in the microphone, but invite you to note the directions. We'll begin by facing the north. Let us pray. We face the north, the season of winter and the elements of earth, and search it for a blessing we might carry into that future. The gift of the North is love, for it speaks of great endurance. Love offers us, above all else, the power of strength in adversity. May we hold love in our hearts and bring to our future the gentle power of strength in adversity and search it for a blessing we might carry into that future. Let us observe a time of silence. We turn to face the east, the direction of the rising sun, the season of spring and the element of air, and search it for a blessing we might carry into that future. The gift of the east is wisdom. In the morning light, we can see and know and understand more clearly. It speaks of the breath of new life on earth. Wisdom offers us, above all else, the confidence to know ourselves more fully. May we hold wisdom before us, and with it, bring to our future the confidence to know ourselves more fully. We turn to the south, the direction of summer and the element of water, and search it for a blessing we might carry into that future. The gift of the south is mystery, for in the silent darkness of the earth, possibility stretches toward its future light. Mystery offers us, above all else, the courage to dream and wait and dream again. May we hold mystery in the depths of our being and bring to our future the courage to dream and wait and dream again. We turn to the west, the place of the setting sun, the season of autumn and the element of fire, and search it for a blessing we might carry into that future. The gift of the west is beauty, for it speaks of great peace and serenity. Beauty offers us, above all else, the freedom to live in wonder and gratitude. May we carry beauty in our lives and bring to our future the freedom to live in wonder and gratitude. We return to face one another. Look at this day, for it is life, the very life of life. In its brief course lie all the verities and realities of your existence, the bliss of growth, the glory of action, the splendor of beauty. For yesterday is but a dream, and tomorrow is only a vision, but today, well lived, makes every yesterday a dream of happiness, and every tomorrow a vision of hope. Look well, therefore, to this day. Amen. A word for humanity. Each birth is a revolution, Whether it happened 1,000 years ago or takes place today, with each birth, the world becomes new. Some are born in a cottage, some in a field, but wherever a child is born, in its eyes, the world is reflected. In its cries, Christ is present. Christ, the Son of Man, was born to renew the world. Like every child in the mother's womb, is granted by the Lord at its time. And a reading from the Good News of Luke, reading from chapter 2, verses 22 to 40. When the time came for their purification, according to the law of Moses, Jesus' parents brought him up to Jerusalem to present him, as it is written in the law of God, every firstborn male child shall be designated as holy to God. And they offered a sacrifice according to what is stated in the law, a pair of turtle doves and 2 young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. This man was righteous and devout, looking forward to the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit rested on him. It had been revealed to Simeon by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen God's Messiah. Guided by the Spirit, Simeon came into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what was customary under the law, Simeon took Jesus in his arms and praised God, saying, Holy One, now you are dismissing your servant in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel. And the child's father and mother were amazed at what was being said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to his mother Mary, this child is destined for the falling and rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be opposed, so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul too. There was also a prophet, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel, of the tribe of Asher. She was of a great age, having lived with her husband 7 years after her marriage, then as a widow to the age of 84. She never left the temple, but worshiped there with fasting and prayer night and day. At that moment, she came and began to praise God and to speak about the child to all who were looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. When the parents had finished everything required by the law of God, they returned to Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth. The child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favor of God was upon him. Here ends our reading from the Good News of Luke. And now a scripture story from our good friend whose wonderful contribution to us over the years was working through Woodlake Publishing and his blog Rumors. Ralph died just a few years ago, but he's left us a treasure trove of story and of faith. And his story is simply entitled Simeon and Anna. Her legs were bowed with childhood rickets and with 84 years of life. I walk like an old goose, she would cackle. But in my mind, in my mind, I still soar like an eagle. Sometimes Anna counted her years by the people she had survived. 5 children she had born and outlived every one of them. She'd been the midwife who brought the high priest of the temple into the world and now acted as his unofficial mother emeritus. "Very unofficial," Anna grins. "His Highness doesn't want it known that I blew his nose and wiped his bum when he was a tadpole. But he comes and talks to me when nobody's looking. It wouldn't do for him to be seen talking to a woman now, would it?" Anna had moved into the temple expecting to die there soon, but death didn't come. Instead, a new kind of life, a life of caring and counseling and friendship to the many people who came in and out of the temple each day. Her body grew smaller, her legs bowed a little more, but her eyes grew bright and gentle with wisdom and good humor. Anna's special concern was for young families. Jewish custom required a firstborn son to be brought to the temple and dedicated to God. "Those parents, they're just children, really. They're so frightened, so anxious. We've got a lot of priests around here, but they're so busy being important, they don't have time for young families. So I just show them around and help them get things done." Anna's special concern was for poor families, intimidated by the wealth and the power on display in the temple, afraid of being cheated by the money changers, as they often were. Anna got them through. That was her mission, getting them through a tough time. But Anna had a secret dream. She hadn't shared it with anyone except her old friend Simeon. Anna and Simeon, like Jews everywhere, had been raised with the hope that someday God would send a Messiah, a chosen one, someone who would bring in a new era of love and justice. "Do you suppose we might see God's chosen one?" old Simon would ask. "Do you suppose it's possible?" "I live in hope, Simeon, I live in hope."
"But how will we know, Anna? How will we know?"
"We'll know, Simeon," Anna said, then wondered why she felt so confident. It was getting late in the day. Anna's bowed legs were tired. She'd been active all day in the temple, in her ministry of simply being there for anyone who needed her. Then she saw a frail teenage girl carrying a baby. Beside her, a man, slightly older. Anna walked over as quickly as her goose-like gait could carry her. "Welcome to the temple, my children." She could see they were hot and tired from their long walk. "Come over here in the shade of the wall. You can rest for a moment. May I see your baby?" It wasn't that the baby looked different than all the other babies brought into the temple. There was nothing unusual about the mother who held it. But there was something very different happening inside of Anna. Something very different indeed. An exquisite ache, a sense of powerful weakness. "Simeon." The name was whispered, but with such intensity, the old man who was dozing nearby woke with a start. He hurried over to Anna. Simeon looked at the child. He saw nothing unusual. But then he looked into the fire-bright eyes of his old friend.
"Anna, do you suppose?"
Her eyes answered his question. Simeon began to sing an ancient song, half remembered, half made up, a song of hope. of hope and thanksgiving, a song of pain and rejoicing. Anna, who had no voice at that moment, sang along in her heart. Dear God, now I can die in peace as you promised. I have seen your salvation, a gift to all people, a light for the Gentiles, and glory for your people, Israel. Late that night, Anna wept long and quietly. She grieved and celebrated all that was and all that was yet to be, and then she slept. It was only a few days later that Anna was a midwife to another kind of birth. Her old friend Simeon was dying, and she was at his side, holding his hand and helping him through it, as she helped so many others through life's changes.
I think I can die now, Anna. I'll know very soon whether that child really is the Messiah, the chosen one. I'll know very soon.
Simeon closed his eyes for the last time. But I know already, my old friend. Sleep well. As we reflect on the story of Anna and Simeon, let us move into a time of prayer. And I want us to both think and celebrate this past year and then reflect on the year ahead. And we're going to light some candles. There'll be some opportunities for silent prayer as we pray together. As we light our first candle, let us celebrate this past year, even as we recognize its challenges and its hardships. We light this candle, remembering the children and young people who were baptized here at Knox, who attended our Spirit Kids Club this past year. The light beams so that all young people may be able to grow up receiving affection and protection. We light this second candle, remembering all those who have experienced grief and loss in our community of faith, the death of a loved one, the ending of a significant relationship, the loss of employment. This light beams for their continuing comfort and care. We light this third candle, remembering all who have shared in ministry in this place, musicians and singers, teachers and leaders, those who offered hospitality through meals or programs and all forms of welcome, those who offered care or reminded us of our wider community, those who visited hospitals or nursing homes, those who cooked meals or offered transport, those who offered care through their calls and contact. This light beams with the acts of compassion offered by and shared in our midst. We light this fourth candle, remembering all those who have visited our community of faith or joined us online in recent times and decided to find a home, a place in our community of faith. This light beams in order that we continue to explore and enjoy everything we have received as a gift. We light this fifth candle, mindful of those who have called us to risk the way of Jesus, to create inclusive and safe, open and honest communities for all. This light beams as a symbol of hope in the midst of both challenge and comfort. We light this sixth candle, having each and every one of us in mind, bearing each other in strengths and weaknesses, anxieties and hopes. This light beams on the pathways we have welcomed and where we didn't want to go. It will continue to shine for each and every one of us on the new pathways we will tread. May we have courage in uncertain times. May we recognize new beginnings in what seem to be endings. And now, as we continue the prayers of our hearts and minds, we take our candle and light our care candle. We think especially in the dawning of a new year of our healthcare providers, our frontline workers, our emergency personnel, our public health staff, all those that will be responding in this time of pandemic to serving, to caring, to healing, to vaccinating. We pray for those who are under significant financial stress or burden at this time. We pray for those struggling with issues of mental health caused by this pandemic or other concerns. We raise our prayers for those that may be struggling alone, particularly those on the margins, those who are most vulnerable. As we see the light of our care candle, we reflect and we offer the prayers of our hearts and minds for ourselves, for those we love, for our world. May we find in this day an awareness of the freedom we are given to know life unshackled from fear and embrace the possibilities of the present with every breath we take. Amen. Thank you for joining us today. We won't be offering a live stream for the next 3 weeks. I have some study leave time away, but we will be offering, you can find on our website and in our email news, links to other United Church services that you may want to check out during this time. We want to wish you a blessed new year, and we hope that that soon, certainly sometime in the next year, we'll be able to be back in person. Those of you that are joining us online from outside of the Brandon area, we are planning to continue to live stream when we are able to be back in person, so know that that will still be available. And now hear this blessing. The presentness of God reaches beyond this place. Our time in this sacred space may have ended, but our connection to each other and our respective communities remain. Together, may we follow the path of justice, speak words of love, live the selfless deed, tread gently upon the earth, and fill the world with compassion. And may the God who dances with creation, who embraces us with human love, who shakes our lives like thunder, bless us and drive us out with power to fill the world with her justice. May it be so. Amen. Mm-hmm.